Welcome speech by Dr. V. Kunyari, Dean of the Faculty of Indology, Sri Shankaracharya Sanskrit University, and the former head of the Department of History, University of Calicut. I invite Mr. Kunyari Sahib to welcome speech.
Respected Siddiqui Sahab and Dr. Shabistan Ghaffar, and my dear friends, we have great pleasure in welcoming amidst us these two great personalities. Sir, your presence, we are honored by your presence. And see, I have never seen this hall so full, and that itself is a great a sign of warm welcome to you. We are looking forward to your speech, which will be very much appreciated and which will be very much useful for the whole of this gathering. Gentlemen, Dr. Siddiqui had been a man of great achievements in his career. In fact, he started his career in 1960 as a lawyer. And then, of course, by his sheer merit and devotion to his works, he was appointed secretary to the Justice Verma Commission in 1991, that is, which was instituted for the inquiry into the Rajiv Gandhi murder case. Then he was appointed the Registrar of the Registrar General of the Supreme Court of India. Later, in 1994, he was appointed Judge of the Madhya Pradesh High Court. Then he was appointed later as member of the Advisory Board for the Reserve Bank of India. Then he later on in 2002, he was appointed as the chairman of the Railway Claims Tribunal, and now serving as the chairman of the National Commission for Minority Education. You know, these records, I just went in detail along the records just to show that Dr. Siddiqui is a man of action, and of course, we hope that we shall have some fruitful guidelines in this direction in his speech now. I am also welcoming Dr. Shabistan Ghaffar, chairperson of the Committee on Girls' Education of the Minority Education Commission. We are happy that you have been kind enough to accept our invitation, and we are looking forward to hear you, very eagerly looking forward to hear you. Then there will be an interaction. Now the Vice Chancellor will be here soon, but sir, the first meeting of the syndicate elected is being held now, so he is busy with that. Anyhow, he has promised to be here. So I now request Dr. Siddiqui Sahab to address the gathering.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Dignities on and off the dais. Ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It's a great pleasure and privilege for me to have this welcome opportunity of addressing you, as who is personally very appreciative of the tremendous contribution that this state has made for upliftment of its people. Mahatma Gandhi ji said, and I quote, "The first thing needful is a sufficient number of self-sacrificing people who devote themselves to the additional work, educational work, as a labor of love, and there is no calling so sacred," unquote. Education forms the backbone of any society. It creates intelligence, consciousness, and perception. A society without these qualities is a vulnerable entity. A community without these qualities cannot contribute in the task of nation building. It cannot contribute to the development of nation, and hence cannot enjoy the fruits of such development. Lack of education thus perpetuates backwardness. Therefore, the index of educational development of a community is the most significant factor in shaping public perceptions about its participation in national building, which in turn characterizes its image and respectability in public life. Therefore, creation of knowledge should be the fundamental objective of higher education, for which we need education of global excellence. Today, education is without borders. Globalization has changed the dynamics of polity and society. In the wake of globalization, our youth need access to good laboratories and enabling infrastructure facilities. There is a shocking shortage of higher quality of education and educational resources. In the wake of globalization, there is a need of systematic transformation of thinking process and the resulting behavior through proper education, research and training. We need to be imaginative in our thoughts and make use of the progress in information and technology. Every nation needs a system of education that is rooted in culture and committed to inclusive growth. In a world torn by strife, fanatism, terrorism and violence, the crucial function of education should be to spread peace. Science and technology is deeply rooted in the idea of peace and religion. Religion too, as Swami Vivekananda has said, is about, and I quote, assimilation and not destruction, and for harmony and peace, not dissension, unquote. While addressing a convocation lecture at the Punjab University, Mr. N.R. Narayan Murthy, an eminent educationist of our country, advised the students, and I quote, consequently, teaching schools and colleges must encompass all major religions with the syllabi updated to include such discussions. His teachings must be started at the elementary school stage rather than being restricted to higher education, unquote. Great scientist Albert Einstein, in his work Science, Philosophy and Religion, a Symposium, emphasized the role of religion in science when he said that, and I quote, a legitimate conflict between science and religion cannot exist. Science without religion is lame, and religion without science is blind, unquote. We have to create a harmonious synthesis between science and religion in this stage of globalization. Globalization has also changed dynamics of the operating system, but the lower status of the minorities has not let them make use of its fruit. Lack of proper schools, unqualified teachers, inadequate books and poverty are the main factor responsible for this current state of affairs. It would be pertinent to mention here that higher education is a serious concern for us. The opportunity for higher education in terms of the intake capacity in our universities is simply not adequate in terms of our need. A far bigger population needs access to quality higher education. For that, the higher education sector needs a sympathetic transformation so that it can educate much larger number of students without diluting academic standards. Now here I may emphasize that enhancement of quality in education is the need of the hour. Now, I am sorry to say that now the standard of our education has fallen below the standard of the at the international stage. So we have to prepare our students for tomorrow. We must strive hard to harness every source that could lead us to quality education, quality in growth, and quality development. Today, the doors of modern industries are open only to those with good schooling and relevant skills. The IT revolution has meant that students need to acquire even higher level of skill. Such radical needs can be fulfilled only with radical transformation of the way education is delivered. The most needed affirmative action in the field of education is to ensure access to quality schooling to children from weaker students. The ambience at their homes is not conducive to the pursuit of studies. This drawback can be overcome only if they are lodged in a well-equipped hostels with trained teachers to guide them. Now, for the minorities, I have only one message, that our salvation lies in acquiring strong knowledge economies powered by information, technology, innovation, and education. Thank you very much for your time and patience. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Siddiqui Sahab. Now I request Dr. Shabistan Ghaffar to address the gathering.
Dignitaries on and off the dais, ladies and gentlemen, good morning, one and all. I am thankful to C.H. Muhammad Koya, Chair for Study on Developing Study, that they have given me an opportunity to share something regarding the education of the backward society or the backward community with you. And I am also extending my gratitude that I have also got an opportunity to meet the young generation of the university, so they might have been well knowing about the problems, which is the today's the topic is regarding empowering the backward through education, what are the problems and prospects. But I am here basically because I have been to Kerala so many times, and luckily I had got chance to meet one and all the people from different region of the Kerala, either it's the Malabar or southern region. So this is the first kind of an interaction. I am seeing lot of young because I am concerned with the women's only, so I am getting an opportunity to listen to them, to interact with them, so how they are successful acquiring the the education, what are the hurdles they are facing for the higher education, what are the there are so many things because women is itself in a minority, because she is not empowered, which is a topic. Like, it's not like minority either they are the Muslims or the Sikhs or the Christians, but women is itself lagging through economically, socially, politically, so she is among the minority. So here is the topic, how we can be able to empower her through I guess that the better way is through education. We can empower the women in all means. If she can get the education, we can empower the generation itself, because I have worked for the girls' education since 3.5 years. I got an opportunity through the commission, which has constituted a committee on girls' education. I am heading that, and through that assignment, I travel all the corner of the country where I interact with so many groups of women. We held more than 300 seminars and conferences, and more than 7 regional conferences also. For the Southern Conference, we had in Chennai in 2011. So we called the people from different, the community. They were from the Christian and the Muslims and other community also, so how they are facing the problems regarding the empowering the girl through education, and what the incentives should be given by the government so that she can be empowered through education. So I compile more than 541 pages of my report, which I submit to Government of India last year in 2012 to HRD Minister Dr. Pallam Raju and other state minister for education. So I have given it to them, and I have given more than 180 recommendations. So what the state government should play the role for women education, what the central government and what the other, I mean the philanthropists, the civil society or the individuals can play the role in elementary education, in higher education, in professional education. So we don't have the similar problem which is in South or in within the state itself is in, like you have the problem in Malabar, that is not similar like you have the problem in southern Kerala like Cochin and this Trivandrum. So same wise the neighboring states which are there adjacent to Kerala, that means Tamil Nadu is there, then Karnataka is there, definitely they have the different issues, different problems, so which are they are getting the hurdle. So for the higher education, by interacting with so many the people who are running the institution, or because our commission is dealing with the education minority education institution, they have the mandate, and Justice Siddiqui Saab is the chairman, and he has done lot of work for the empowerment of minorities through education, because by helping them in legal way under Article 29-30 of the Constitution, that is the vast subject. You can go through the website and you will come to know how tremendous the work has been done by the Commission. But he felt during his travel like this, why this girl is backward and what are the hurdles. So we can compile the report and we can give present it to the commission, this Government of India. So many recommendation has been taken by the planning commission, and they have formulated in shape of the scheme. Like there is Maulana Azad Foundation is giving the exclusively the scholarship for girls. And there are other things like for higher education, we recommend for the Maulana Azad Fellowship is also there, for the UGC is giving that scholarship, and other professional, colleges, the AICT through MCI, there are so many schemes also, and we also request Women and Child Development Ministry so that they can be able to help the women, and they can empower them socially, educationally and politically and economically also. So let me tell you, I want to share because I didn't want to enlighten about the importance of girls' education, because here is the mature group enough, they are here, they know, so I need not to discuss about what is happening and why it is important. So better I am here, I want to listen you all. I want to have the interaction with you. So why they are opting this art subject, why the girls are not going for the science and technology oriented subjects. So because maybe they are not aware about the future, about the benefits if they can opt, and what, how they can help them, and how that can help in the growth for our development of our country also. We are the citizen of India. So we want our India should be superpower, but not that we are taking the arts and faculty subject, arts subject. That too is very important, because there is the culture, literature, history that we can take as an optional. I am being myself as a medical doctor. I have done the MBBS, but I am doing the different work. So nobody, I am learning from the, because I don't have the very good background of the arts. I am from the science subject, but this was my passion because I thought ki I will involve myself to this cause so that I can be able to become the source and like I can generate the awareness. So that way I have done tremendous work by the grace of Almighty. So we have also established and motivated the people, like the people which are not having the access for the education, especially the girls in the northeast, like in the Bengal, like because north is tremendously backward. But I am very much surprised today morning I was thinking that I have the talk over here empowering the backwards. So Israeli in Kerala there are the backward people, because you have the access of lot of institutions established by all the communities, whether it is the Christian or the Muslims or the Hindus. Because I have felt because so many people are very much, so I was just traveling to come to this place, I saw one house, there was written education and counseling center. So it was in some house. So I thought how much people are conscious and they are very much concerned for the upliftment and they want to educate, and that is reflecting because the people of Kerala are rapidly progressing in all ways. Either it is a political, it is a economical, it is a social, that is the visible. So everybody is saying that Kerala is growing, but there are so many drawbacks. In terms of the women's, like the dowry is the one of the issue which I have come to know since 3 and 4 years, because I am traveling to Kerala since 2010, and I travel 3-4 times at least per year. So I have interact with there is a dowry is a such an evil, and we had one program for women discrimination, why the violence goes on. And yesterday we had one graduate congress in MES Medical College, and we found there 80% of girls were the only who has taken the degrees. The majority of the students were the girls and the boys were very less. Why there is and side by side I came to know that here is the the very speed of this divorce is there, the splitting of family is there, because I interact with so many doctors who are there, so they were briefing me why it happens. If the Kerala is having the 100% literacy, or they not mentally educated, why these things are? So we need to work on those lines. We need to sensitize these things. We need to educate the civil, the societies also, so that they can generate the awareness up to the grassroots level, so that we cannot be able to promote the social evil, which is the dowry. And what are the effects of the dowry, like which I mentioned, there may be the domestic violence, there may be some other kind of violence also which are hidden, because the people are educated, they are the conscious, they don't want that things should get visible. So I am here, so I want to interact with the youth. So why they are going for the arts? Is it like they have the financial constraint, so they are not able to go for the science subject? Is there a less motivation, or there is not the access for this higher education in science and technology oriented? Because now we are seeing that science and technology, more girls are opting and they are working in so many the areas in which are very challenging. But why there is the restriction, this is the question mark. So I now want to listen from you. Maybe I may have some doubts. I can get the more, because here it's a well qualified youth, because they have come to up to the level of the university. They are the mature audience who are here. So I just want to come from you and learn from you what is the actually the status of the girls. Then I can like I can listen and I can give my suggestions how we can be able to come up from these things. Thank you for your time and patience. I am here to listen to you. Thank you so much.
Now, this time for interaction. But madam, I would like to tell you that these students are not from arts alone. They are students from arts and science and every discipline. You go to our campus, you will find in all the science departments also girls are more in number. Just as you said, there are more people in medical colleges, girls. Now, it is for you people to say or to bring up your problems. You see, there is a proverb in Urdu. शिकायत उनसे करना है जिनसे कुछ उम्मीद भी है. यू शुड कंप्लेन टू दोस फ्रॉम होम यू हैव गॉट सम होप ऑफ रेक्टिफाइंग यूर ग्रीवेंसेस. सो दिस इज द बेस्ट ओकेशन एंड दिस इज द बेस्ट स्टेज. सो आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट ऑल ऑफ यू जस्ट एज मैडम हैज सजेस्टेड यू जस्ट योर डाउट्स यूर से आई मीन देन ऑफकोर्स शी विल बी एबल टू वेल वी विल बी एबल टू इंटरेक्ट एंड देन ऑफकोर्स I hope something will come out of it. Thank you. Now, you are all welcome to raise say your problems in this session.
That is the, I don't know why, this is the biggest drawback. But you need to prepare them. You need, because that is to the part of education, personality development. That too is the part of education.
Professor Siddiqui, that we have been hearing the speeches of these two personalities for about 2-3 days. I have a point to be clarified that what are the constitutional remedies for those who break the or who do against the rules and regulations of the minority commission, or I want to know whether there are any constitutional remedies against the wrongdoers of the constitution, sir.
As regards the minorities, the government of India has set up my commission, that is National Commission for Minority Educational Institutions Act, to safeguard the educational rights of the minorities enshrined in Article 30 of the Constitution. Now, Article 30 confers two fundamental rights on the minorities, that they can establish educational institutions of their choice and they can also administer them. And there is a provision in our act that if during an inquiry it is found that the particular officer has deliberately violated the educational rights of the minorities, then on the recommendation of the commission, the state government is bound to take disciplinary action against the erring official within 1 month from the date of the order. So that is the instant provision preventing the officers or bureaucrats from violating the education rights, fundamental rights of the minorities enshrined in them. I suppose as non-minorities or minorities are both these persons, there is a provision in the constitution and there is some judge-made laws that if any bureaucrats deliberately violates the fundamental rights guaranteed to the citizens of India, then the High Court and the Supreme Court award adequate compensation to the complainant, to the writ petitioner. So, every right, there is no right without a remedy. Remedies are available either in the Constitution or by the some judgments rendered by the constitutional courts of our country, including the Supreme Court. So, as far as the state minority commissions are concerned, they are teethless tigers. They have no power. That is only a recommendatory body. Its their recommendations may or not be accepted by the government. So according to me, the state minority commissions have no role to play. So far as the enforcement of the rights of the minorities are concerned, they are caged parrots. So they have no positive role to play. But our commission is a very proactive commission. It's a quasi-judicial tribunal, and it enjoys all trappings of a court. The commission has been invested with the powers to decide the dispute between a college and the affiliating university relating to affiliation of the college. And it says the decision of the commission thereon shall be final. Then the commission has been invested with the jurisdiction for determining the minority status of a minority educational institution. And suppose if the state government does not grant minority status, then certainly an appeal lies to the commission. So this is a very proactive commission. It is not a parking lot for vintage cars. Anything else?
See, there are so many who have come from various institutions, quite eager to know, especially from minority institutions. So, they will raise some questions. കുറെ സ്ഥാപനങ്ങളിൽ നിന്ന് ആൾക്കാർ വന്നിട്ടുണ്ടല്ലോ. അപ്പം പറയാനുള്ളത് മലയാളത്തിൽ പറഞ്ഞാൽ മതി, നമ്മൾ ട്രാൻസ്ലേറ്റ് ചെയ്ത് കൊടുത്തോളാം. സ്വാഭാവികമായിട്ടുണ്ടാവും.
ഹലോ ഹലോ സർ, ഇറ്റ്സ് എ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ഫ്രം ആൻറ്റിസിപ്പേറ്റഡ് ആങ്സൈറ്റി. Now, what would be the fate of the minority commission if there is a change in the ministry of the central government? Can the power be revoked or not? Can the powers of the minority commission can be revoked as per the constitution or not?
You know, this commission has been set up under an act of parliament. Suppose if the government changes at the center, it cannot repeal the act. It is the parliament which has the sole power of repealing the act. And I think no government will dare to repeal the act, which is a very beneficial piece of legislation for the minorities. It's available to a minority educational institution. After obtaining the minority status certificate, I can explain to that also. But there must be some question if anybody wants to know.
Chai. Yes, I want to hear something from the Madrasa modernization program of the Government of India.
You know, the Government of India has simply launched beneficial schemes for providing modern education in the madrasa. Not the government does not want to modernize the madrasa. That field cannot be encroached upon by the government. So they have certainly launched some beneficial scheme providing modern education in the madrasa, because you know, in the wake of globalization of education, we have to equip our madrasas with modern education also.
Yes.
So I have question to Ms. Ma'am Shabista. Nowadays in Kerala, Muslim girls. Okay, I am Muslima. PG student in Department of Arabic. Nowadays in Kerala, Muslim girls, especially Muslim girls, are coming forward for education in these days. But when they are getting married, the education is discontinued. In some rare cases it is continuing and going very good manner. And there is one other aspect, that is there are a lot of graduates in Muslim families. When they are getting married, they continue their education, and when they complete their courses, they are just sitting their homes. They look forward their children, and their life is going in that manner. We know that a mother has the responsibility to look after her children, but the society has to take the responsibility to give her the space for a work. This is a problem, but not, it is a what I say, the overall community is not like that. I am a married girl, and my husband and my family all are helping and supporting me to give and to acquire knowledge and to continue my study. I am both an Arabic student, and I am trying to get a chartered accountant, and I have completed the preliminary steps. And this is one side, but there is one another side also. My question is that what girls education, I forgot your commission, girls education can do for this state of Kerala or this state of Muslim or any other community girls.
Why? Because they don't want money that women should earn. Or
money, in some cases money is maybe a problem, but the most of the cases the mind of people is not well educated about the importance of acquiring knowledge or the importance of working woman. In Kerala, we all know that in earlier times, ancient times, girls have no right to education. But now it is changed. But still, the mind of whatever people is something backward in case of giving or acquiring knowledge after marriage.
So even in the teaching, like you have so many schools, colleges,
okay.
So women are also not permission that they could go for the teaching and all that, they should go for the they can help the schools and institutions, they don't permit the parents or the in-laws, don't permit them to go for a work in school also.
I said that all of them like that. There are so many teachers in Kerala, Muslim women teachers in Kerala, but as you said, all the Muslim girls are focusing to this teaching field only.
Why not in different, like medical is there, paramedical is there, technical education is there,
and medical field also we can see in medical colleges lot of Muslim girls, but after their graduation what are they doing? Or after, in engineering colleges there are a lot of Muslim girls, but after their graduation, what are they doing? The question is, they are in their homes. They have nothing in their that subject area.
What, according to you, you have the solution for this problem? Because we are talking, because you are the part of this place, you know the psyche, the culture, everything. So according to you, because you have realized this suffocation or kind of thing you want, like you are in Arabic stream now, you are doing the chartered accountant, this is like different field, but you have the passion. So what is the solution? Because you are the part of that, those families also, because I am outsider, I am North Indian, we have the different problems, we have the different approach of the things. So how you will find, like what should be done for this problem, the solution is for this?
In my opinion, the solution is awaring the minds of people. That is what.
Whenever I talk to men folk who are the representative of the institutions or who are the representative of this
civil societies, I can say, they are very modern. Whenever I raise the question regarding this, they are very reluctant. They don't want to touch this topic. This is kind of like you want to generate the awareness. That can be through only the NGOs or through the representative of the educational institution, so that they can give the advocacy, what are the merits for the working women and how they can be involved. But there is a reluctance. So that way we are not able to, because dowry is such a thing here, I have heard, and I feel like that is the biggest social evil in the society. Because one side, like in the Muslim family, they are very conservative about the thing. So the head of the family, he travels for this job or employment to the Gulf countries, leaving behind their wives and children alone. What are the effects and the drawbacks that they are coming after 1 year? How they are ignoring, that too is not good, because there is a compulsion. I have the daughter and she is going to get married, I have to earn lot of money for that. Is that all? That is one face of that the society. Is that permitted in our Islam? No. If they are very reluctant that girl should not go for the work or whatever, so but there are other things. They are collecting the dowry. That too is an evil. That is not permitting in Islam. If they every time blame that Islam is restricting this thing and that thing, that's a very huge. So you need to generate the awareness within yourself. And I guess ki they are culturally, religiously, they are having the good, knowledge, the girl, they are giving them the education. They will never betray their trust of the parents or the in-laws, whatever. That is the only question. That is the only question. So what is the solution? Tell me.
My solution is that I have said, but I have to know what the government or officials can do.
They can't do, because it's the social problem. It's
social
not the government problem.
Only can be solved by society only.
So government has set is the modernization, and people were very aggressive initially. Why we will modernize them? The madrasa, the justice sahab has enlightened you that it is modern education. So government never wants to modernize the madrasas. These are the two things. So how come the government will interfere? Like, that is the issue at the the society or the community or the state level. So you need to generate the awareness. You need to have the talk regarding these things, to discuss, to take the good thing. Like, see, in Karnataka you will see lot of women, those who are very much practicing Muslim women, they have established the schools, they are in jobs, they are in ITs, so they are taking care of their family, their children, so there is no harm in it. So look, if you have to quote, like we have Hazrat Khatijatul Kubra radiallahu ta'ala anha, she was the richest woman of the world. Till now nobody is that much rich, and she should be the role model for the Islamic feminism. You should be aware of the Islamic study also. We'll give the reference, like Hazrat Fatima Zahra radiallahu ta'ala anha was there. Even the Hazrat Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha was having more the ahadith, you know, after Abu Huraira. She was there, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught her for 9 years. So there was one lady, Hazrat Aisha Siddiqa radhiyallahu ta'ala anha, she was knowing Quran by heart. She was like, there are so many things, so many women, and from 7th century up to now, we have the enough in our Islamic history or Muslim history, we can say, the lot of women, those who have contributed enough for the society.
So you need to aware, because it's not like five times namaz is there, that is the part of, I mean, the practicing, and other good things are also in other religions. They are not, they are also differentiating between good and bad. Everywhere is the teaching of harmony and goodness and everything. But we should also set the example, what is the history of Islamic women's? What is the history of Muslim women's in India? You can select the topic, have the debate, and have the interaction among you. You need to generate the awareness. By that, gradually the mindset of, like, initially there just share that women's were not allowed for the education. Why the mindset changed? So you need to gradually change the setup of, and we have to aware the men's first. That's very important. They should know and they should permit. So there are the equal rights. Indian constitution has also given the equal rights both for women and men, and our Islam has also given the equal right 1432 before that. So we need to change the mindset. After you are giving the good education to the girls, then you are not involving them for in the society for the betterment. See, I have seen, I will not mention, I went to so many gatherings, very elite gatherings in Kerala, where I have found they are wearing the very costly jewelries and the clothes very high, but they are not able to communicate. They don't know why we are here and what we have to talk. There is not any sensible kind of an interaction between the women, which is for the social development, which is for the community development. I never found. They are always there, ma'am. That is not only the part we are getting the good jewelries and the good food and the good clothes. That is not the end of the, like, we are now in a, but we should behave as a good human, as a civilized human. That need to be, you have to work very hard, you have to generate the awareness, you have to also invite the friends who are the like-minded. That way the things can change.
Madam, the problem is that it is a bit different from North India and South India.
Why?
Especially, you see, in our area, especially among the Muslims, the marriage age is something like 16 or 17, average. And they just become mothers within 1 or 2 years. And then once she become mother, then the family compels her to just to look after the children. You know, then finally, gradually, well, by the time the girl is, by the child is 1 or 2 years, well, the other child. Well, in fact, we have no limit for the number of children.
Have you heard about the Jamia Millia Islamia? Yes. Everybody is knowing. So, have you heard about the Maulana Johar Ali? Yes. He was a big freedom fighter. Yes. Have you heard about him?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Everybody is knowing. Yes. Do you know, his mother was Bi Amma. Abida was her name. At the age of 30, her husband died. At the age of 30. Very tender age. So she was having 4 sons and 1 daughter. She provided them the best education. She sold her all the jewelries. And what was the name? She was also the mother, married mother. That should not be the reason. So after marriage, the life is cut off from the society or from the world. We have 1,000 number of Muslim women, those who have contributed after marriage. See, Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan, he was shaped by her mother only. All the education was given to him by her mother. So we have enough, like, we need to, reach this message to these girls. So they can balance between the family, religious, and the married life, and working life. They have to balance with 3 things, because they are unaware with the history of rest part of the world. There are number of examples, we can say. So see, the Christian girls, I appreciate the community, Christian community contribution all over the world people are contributing. They are training for the paramedical. And all the manpower supplied for the nursing to all the hospitals all around the world is through the Christians. And that is also the basic teaching of our Islam. During the jungs, you know, the ladies were involved for this hospital, medical kind of first aid and all kind of this. Why not we Muslims are providing our teacher, our daughters, our sisters, the paramedical? So they are very reluctant. They should, they will allow them to go and get the degree from MBBS because they have the lot of money, and after that they will do her good marriage in somewhere. So they will not find that ladies also need the lady doctors and the lady nurse. So this can be also promoted over here for
now
the girls.
Let me answer her question. Sorry for the interruption. You know, the Islam has given equal status to women, but we have denied that status to them. Secondly, the personality development subject is wholly alien to the Muslims of this country. Now there are certain perceptions. You know, some want to have a wife because it is a very cheap labor available in this country. Then the other thought is that let them have sufficient time for bringing up his children. There is no, they don't believe in family planning, so they can't plan their family. So there is a need to educate the Muslims that please let them have an independent personality, although she is your wife, but she is not your servant. Let her have an opportunity to develop her personality, either through education or through social service. So there is a need to educate the Muslim community. That's all.
Excuse me. Let me have my own idea about this problem. First of all, we are dealing with a very problematic thing. Social issues are raised here, which curbs the free mobility of educational mobility of women as well as the professional mobility of the women. Actually, the problems they are feeling are the pulls of the social forces. These pulls of the social forces are to be dealt with from different angles, from religious people, from social people. Even you see the mentality of an average Keralite is that the three most important thing in his life or her life is marriage, home, and something good for posterity. That I think is the minimum wish of a normal Keralite. We are thinking from Kerala, we are thinking from Malabar. It is not merely the case of the minorities. It's a general perception of a Keralite, I think. You see, I think when girls are being sent to colleges, most of the people think here their blissful destiny after education is marriage alone, and bringing up the family and all that. Nothing more, nothing less. Last year, when economics came, I am teaching history in a nearby college. When economist came to our college, and he said that 65% of the students of the colleges in Kerala are women nowadays for last 5 years. And at the same time, he said that their representation in employment is only 5%. 5%. That is the general scenario of Kerala itself. No, Professor Kannan was saying that. So that is the general scenario. Here the problem is that we are trying to solve a social issue
from the intervention from the government which is supported by the constitution. I have at this point one maybe a suggestion. Suggestion is that let's think about giving some scholarship to married women who are studying in the colleges and professional colleges. That would be a very good idea to be extended in the forums of discussion for the promotion of education among the married women in Kerala. That's my humble suggestion.
Madam, I have another suggestion. See, at least in one college, nearby women's college, they have started crèche, so that the students, even their babies in arms, you know, they can come and just leave their children in the crèche, and then they can go
to... started?
Yes, started, yes, already. So this will be a better suggestion, because every college like that must have that babies, that is, facilities for babysitting or say crèche. So that married people, married women can also come and study, continue their colleges, their studies. Otherwise, see, they are just confined to look after the houses, to look after their children only. So this is a drawback. And once they are cut off from the education and classes, then there is no way of bringing them back again. So the one college at least have started that, in a nearby college. That's a women's college. This will be a very good idea. That can, even the commission can take it probably.
A question to you, madam. I'm Munshida, I'm doing MMAT. And my question is, in Kerala, of science subjects, regular courses are varied and recognized. But so, as a family member, to me, I'm a mother and a student also. So, we are suffering so many problems to do the regular courses. So, for science subjects, is there any solution to overcome this problem? If we are continuing the regular course, we have to admit our children to play school or crèche. But sometimes the society will take it in a negatively. So, for science subject also, is there any distance studies offering? But this this university, the Calicut University also, they are not offering the distance studies in science subjects. In Tamil Nadu, there are so many colleges, but Calicut University and some, in Kerala, I think no university is there not approving that. So, as a commission agent, can you suggest any remedies for this? Thanks. There are in Kerala, no universities are there approving that or recognizing that. For attending the regular courses in in PG and PhD also, there are no part-time courses in science subjects. No. I did my graduation in physics. So, I did my graduation in physics. That's why. Yeah, regular I completed in, yeah.
No problem.
Oh, even no problem,
especially
IGNO international, national.
For IGNO courses, they are not recognized by Calicut University.
IGNO centers were here.
What?
You don't have the IGNO study centers here.
Yeah, JIDT and FADU College. But I think the MSc Physics, they are not approving.
Okay.
And Calicut University...
Aligarh University Center is there.
Our university not recognizing all these subjects.
What about courses, the Aligarh Center you have in Mallapura? Is that not giving you the this? They are not offering you these courses? Aligarh Muslim University Center, Mallapura.
They are not certified so far.
This is the...
MBA relative.
No, they have an idea of starting a women's polytechnic testing.
So that you have the enough women polytechnic. This they should offer these science courses for these women.
Science courses are there.
Because polytechnical colleges are so many over here. You have the ITIs, you have the engineering, so many. But you should demand for this.
Problem is not that math. The question she asked is due to delivery and due to the bringing up of the children.
She is desiring for the science for this through the distance education. She is saying that we don't have the any kind of a college or the university who are offering the science distance. So she, the question is like that. So Aligarh University can cater this demand. Like we can give this suggestion. Very nice suggestion.
Thank you, ma'am.
I will share with you my email ID. So whoever wants to me to convey through email, I will just write it down. Shabistan Ghaffar. It's shabistangaffar@gmail.com. It's shabistangaffar@gmail.com. Anybody wants to share with
me? Shabistangaffar.
वो लोग बंद करेंगे ना, वोट ऑफ थैंक्स करेंगे.
In other societies, we have so many empowered in this sense, women. In India too, in other communities, Hinduism, Christianism, but all kinds of vices seen in this non-empowered women in, for example, this Muslim community is there in other communities also, who are much empowered in this sense. Because you might have heard of these atrocities on women in Delhi and in other our metropolitan cities, etc. But in my sense, this empowerment should be the empowerment of women in the line of becoming good mothers and to bringing up their children as better personalities, etc. But what I don't understand is this mere giving, imparting education, this formal education I mean, can it be an easier way for getting this woman empowered? I don't feel so, because this empowerment should be being education, this moral education in the first place. And for this, I also request Justice Siddiqui to give a good stress in this field, this madrasa education. As he said, this madrasas cannot be changed by government, but this education in madrasas should be changed by giving this education as well as this religious education in the better sense. Then only this, at least this Muslim education, I mean women, can be empowered in the better sense. That's all.
Hello. I had submitted a report along with the draft and an act of the Central Madrasa Boards Act. The Christians have ICSC, the government has CBSC, then why not the Muslims should have their Central Madrasa Board? And we have drafted the act, it is our website, you can download it. They have said that the government has no right to interfere in any area of this Central Madrasa Board. This act, the board, should be an autonomous body free from any interference from the central government. The central government cannot impose anybody in this Madrasa Board. There are 12 and 30, more than 13 Madrasa Boards in other states, where the government has full control. They are not being opposed by the our religious leaders. But when I have mooted this idea, and I have suggested that we have so many maslaks, every maslak should have representation in the madrasa board. That will provide a common platform for them to resolve their maslaki disputes. Unfortunately, this madrasa board was supported by 90% Muslims, particularly our younger generation. But 5 or 10 maulanas, they opposed it. I had sent them the Urdu translation of this, our act, the proposed act, and I asked him to please, the advisor, please point out where is the defect. It did not evoke any response. But they have opposed it for their vested interest. Now it is under consideration of the government, and I don't think that they will agree to that. They are following 300 years old Dars-e-Nizami syllabus for the madrasa. 300 years old. Much water has gone under the bridge. No, madrasa is an Arabic word meaning school.
Yes, of course, Arabic first.
So, the government has no idea to interfere in the religious affairs of the Muslims. Now, when I drafted the act, one of the religious, unscrupulous politician, he said that on the suggestion, on the dictates of the President Bush, Siddiqui Sahib had drafted this act. So these are kinds of negative thinkings which have actually brought us to this sorry state of affairs. If I say that our Maulvi should be at least a graduate one, what sin I have committed in making such suggestion? They can't enter in that interact with the other religious leaders of the community. It is for you to generate awareness. The government is not going. Now, a writ has been filed in the Delhi High Court directing the state government to set up a state madrasa board. And the High Court has directed the state government to constitute. But still it has not been constituted. So because, you know, we have certain social taboos, and we have number of munafiqeens, unbelievers, that is our problem. We have not created any social reformist. So, and we are just simply following the policy of status quo. That is in fact damaging you and your generations to come.
എനിക്ക് ചോദിക്കാനുള്ളത് മൈനോറിറ്റി വിഭാഗം, ഇപ്പൊ നമ്മൾ റിലീജിയനെ കുറിച്ച് മാത്രമേ ഇവിടെ പറഞ്ഞിട്ടുള്ളൂ. മൈനോറിറ്റി കമ്മീഷന്റെ പരിധിയിൽ ഡിസേബിൾ പേഴ്സൺസിനെ ഉൾപ്പെടുത്തിയിട്ടുണ്ടോ എന്ന് എനിക്കറിയണം. പിന്നെ അങ്ങനെയാണെങ്കിൽ ഞങ്ങൾക്ക് എന്തെങ്കിലും പരാതി നിങ്ങളിലേക്ക് എന്തെങ്കിലും കാര്യങ്ങൾക്ക് നിങ്ങളെ സമീപിക്കാൻ പറ്റുമോ എന്നറിയണം. പിന്നെ ഡിസേബിൾ പേഴ്സൺസ് ഒത്തിരി ഗേൾസ് മെയിൻ സ്ട്രീമിലേക്ക് വരാതെ, എഡ്യൂക്കേഷൻ ഇല്ലാതെയൊക്കെ ഒത്തിരി പേര് ഇപ്പോഴും ഉണ്ട്. അപ്പോൾ അവർക്ക് വേണ്ടി എന്തെങ്കിലും മൈനോറിറ്റി കമ്മീഷൻ്റെ ഭാഗത്തു നിന്ന് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഗേൾസ് ഈ മാഡത്തിന് എന്തെങ്കിലും ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുമോ എന്ന് എനിക്ക് അറിയണമെന്നുണ്ട്.
കമ്മീഷൻ ഫോർ ദിസ് യെസ് challenge, disabled challenge these for those women or whatever.
Okay.
This is a separate commission for this.
Okay, thank you.
What's his name who was briefing? I just want
my question is there any provision for minorities or Muslims for reservation in Aligarh Muslim University?
You know, Aligarh Muslim University is a central university. In fact, in a judgment rendered by the constitutional bench, headed by Chief Justice Wancho, has done great damage to this university. Now, the judgment says that, look here, it was funded by the Muslim University. Are you aware of the history of the Muslim University? You know, this the Aligarh Muslim University originated in a madrasa, upgraded to a high school, and then when a movement was launched for giving it a university status, then there at that time there was two universities, Banaras Hindu University and the Aligarh Muslim University. Now the government asked the Banaras University to collect 50 lakhs as endowment and for Aligarh 30 lakhs. Now Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan and the other teachers, they collected 30 lakhs. They gave it to the government with a request to kindly establish a university for the Muslims. Now there was no act or rule giving and empowering a community to establish a private university. The university has to be established under the sovereign powers of the state. They have transferred their assets, their land, their building, everything. And it was act passed as a Aligarh Muslim University. Then you know the late Chagla, he wanted to show the world that it is more secular than anybody in the country. So he has done the damage. And of course the damage was not as much as has been projected by the Supreme Court. And I say still that the judgment rendered by the Supreme Court is a height of judicial freak. It's a Muslim university. Whole fund has been provided by the Muslims. And if you don't want to say that, then return to us the 30 lakhs along with the interest in 1920. Return our land and buildings. And you may set up another central university. So because it is a central university and the matter is still sub judice before the larger bench in the Supreme Court, so until it is declared by the Supreme Court that it is a minority education institution, the reservation policy for the Muslim cannot be extended to the Aligarh Muslim University. Of course, our commission has granted minority status to the Jamia Millia Islamia. Because now the ground which was taken in opposition to the petition was that it is a central university and it was also funded by some non-Muslims, particularly Gandhiji. And I said that this university was established by late Maulana Muhammad Ali Jauhar. At that time all the prominent national leaders, they have donated everything to this university, and it was the only university where the students were being taught how to fight the freedom struggle of the country. That is the contribution of that university. And the opposition was that it was a national university, it is a central university. I said, it was born as a university. Jamia Millia was born as a university because the Jamia is an Arabic word meaning university. You have simply provided a beautiful cloth of central university, so please you can take it off. The soul of the university is the minority education institution. So let us wait the verdict of the Supreme Court, and I am hopeful that now the judges of the Supreme Court will not be able to uphold the judgment rendered by the another constitutional bench in Aziz Pasha case.
There is no reservation for any community, but only 50% of the seats are reserved for those people who take the basic qualification from that degree. For example, Aligarh, yes. If you just pass plus two from Aligarh, you get 50% reservation for degrees. And if you just pass MBBS from Aligarh, you get 50% reservation for MS. Otherwise, the other 50% is open to all. That is all.
Sir, we cannot avail the benefit of the Article 31 of
We had a fruitful discussion and very good interaction, and suggestions have come up. But I would just like to again bring up to the notice of Madam that a suggestion made by one of our friends, that is scholarship for married students continuing their education. Scholarships?
Yeah.
Okay, yes. Okay. Right. And another suggestion that instead of modernizing madrasa, that is modern subjects like clinical psychology, something like that can be added in the curriculum. Anyway, I thank all the people for such a very active interaction. Now I request Mujib, I call him for the vote of thanks.
On behalf of CH Muhammad Goya Chair, I express all gratitude to Justice M.S. Siddiqui for delivering this interaction program. And we express the vote of thanks to Dr. Sabistan Ghaffar, Chairperson, Committee on Girls Education, National Commission for Minority Education Institutions. We express thanks to Dr. V. Kunyali, who presides this session. He is the Dean of the Faculty of Indology, Sri Shankaracharya Sanskrit University. And we are very happy for the participation of our team, the Department of Education of the Calicut University and Department of Arabic of the Calicut University, and various leaders and organizers of the educational institutions in Malabar area, and the scholars of this area. We are very happy for your participation in the interaction. Let us wind up this program. We are CH Muhammad Goya Chair. We are conducting many discussions and talks and interaction with eminent personalities like this. We are very welcome for the future programs in this occasion. Thank you very much.